Let us try to analyze ano ang ibig sabihin nung progressive scheme of taxation sa Constitution. Ano ang ibig sabihin nito? Okay, ang ibig lang sabihin nito is whenever the Congress is enacting a tax law, all right, they should try their best to address their intention to the ability to pay principle of the people. Okay, so they should come up with many rates from the lowest to the highest. So that is what we call progressive scheme of taxation. So you will see na ang ating income tax tumutugma sa progressive scheme of taxation because sa tax code, ang income tax rate ng individual taxpayer.
Action by a party sues another for enforcement or protection of a right or prevention or redress of a wrong. So what are the keywords here? Enforcement, protection of right, prevention or redress of wrong. Tandaan nyo, enforce, protect, right, prevent, redress, wrong. Okay. Remedy by which a party seeks to establish three things: status, right, particular fact. Okay. Ano yung sa television, yung commercial? SRP. Ano yung SRP? Suggested retail price. So tandaan nyo, to establish S.
For the amendment, and for every allegation, it should be supported by evidence because evidence is the means sanctioned by the rules in a judicial proceeding to establish what that equals to the truth. So if there is an allegation supported by evidence, then you're able to establish to the truth. But now it has been adjusted. Kindly take note of that. Why? Because today, for purposes of filing a pleading, for purposes of initiating a complaint, and this would include all other pleadings, even responsive pleadings, what is now the requirement of Google under Rule 6? That together with a pleading, initiatory pleading, which is made as an integral part thereof, would be what? Judicial agreements.
What is our definition of the practice of law? We have three very good definitions of the practice of law. The practice of law is a profession. It is not a business or trade. Lawyering is not primarily meant to be a money-making venture. And law advocacy is not a capital that necessarily yields profits. Duty to the public service and to the administration of justice should be the primary consideration of lawyers. And gaining a livelihood is a secondary consideration. Very good definition, easier said than done. So our primary consideration is to administer justice. Gaining a livelihood is a secondary consideration only for us lawyers. Another definition of the practice of law.
In spouses Minjola Bulisport of Appeals, the Supreme Court devised or laid down tests in determining whether a counterclaim is compulsory or permissive. There are four questions to be asked, my friends. The first question is, you check, okay? Sabi ko, compulsory or claim arises out or it is necessarily connected with transaction occurrence which is the subject matter of the complaint. Pag sinabi mong compulsory counterclaim, kaibigan, it is an offshoot of the complaint. There is a logical connection between the counterclaim and the subject matter of the complaint. Kaya sa bar exam, tingnan nyo ang apat na test na ito. Number one, are the issues of fact or law raised?
What is a dispute? The dispute is a disagreement on a point of law or fact, a conflict of legal views or interests between two persons, natural or juridical. In the Republic Act 9285 or the ADR Act of 2004, it is defined as a process or procedure used to resolve a dispute or controversy other than by adjudication of a presiding judge of a court or an officer of a government agency in which a neutral third party participates to assist in the resolution of issues, which includes arbitration, mediation, conciliation, early neutral evaluation, mini trial, or any combination thereof. So we take note of the meaning. It is a process or a procedure.
Thank you. these provisions in the Constitution indirectly affecting taxation. One is due process. And there are two aspects of due process. Procedural due process. And of course, the substantive due process. You know what is procedural due process? Well, if the imposition of a tax requires certain steps or legal processes to be followed, well, failure to follow them would make the act a violation of due process. One good example here is the assessment of taxes by the Bureau of Internal Revenue or by the government, where the procedure is laid down under Section 228 of the National Internal Revenue Code. So, any deviation from those rules would be a violation of procedural due process.
Now, lifetime of a PRO issued by the RTC, by the Court of Appeals, and by the Supreme Court. So, if it is issued by the RTC, you have 20 days. Within the 20-day period, then there shall be a hearing. The hearing is mandatory as regards to the application for preliminary injunction, either mandatory or prohibitory. Now, after the lapse of the 20-day period, and there is no injunction issued, it becomes functus officio. Now, as far as Court of Appeals is concerned, the lifetime is 60 days. Now,
what appears to be a discriminatory act on the part of government or agents of the government. The proper right to invoke there is the right to the Equal Protection Clause. Because remember, the right to the Equal Protection Clause is a right against any kind of discrimination or discriminatory act on the part of government. So that is a broad formula. So if what is involved, I repeat, is an act of government that appears to be arbitrary, whimsical, capricious, oppressive, unreasonable, confiscatory, and you want to challenge that, you invoke your right to due process law. On the other hand, the Equal Protection Clause is a guarantee against any kind of discrimination or discriminatory act.
First, let us speak of the principles of generality and territoriality. Remember that questions about these two principles were asked in the 2015, 2017, 2018, and 2019 bar examinations. Okay. So far as generality is concerned, consider the persons which are exempt from the general application of Philippine criminal law by virtue of the principles of public international law. And the person exempt from criminal from the application of Philippine criminal law are the sovereigns, chief of states, we have ambassadors, ministers, very potentially.
Party rests case and real evidence consists of objects offered in court. Example, you may use a physical object to demonstrate its existence or identity. Like for example, the serial number on a computer found in a private residence could identify it as a government-owned property. Or for example, the gun that was used in case of murder. Now the other type will be testimonial evidence. And what is testimonial evidence? You call a person to take the witness stand and his testimony is offered to prove, is being offered to prove specific purposes. The third type will be your documentary evidence. It is formally offered by the proponent immediately before he rests his case. A document may be an object of evidence or a documentary evidence depending on the person.
In the Constitution that the JBC, the Judicial and Bar Council, shall be composed of 7 members. The Chief Justice as ex officio chairperson, the Secretary of Justice, very specific, as a member, ex officio member, and then a member from Congress, and then 4 other regular members, a representative from the retired Supreme Court Justices, very specific, a representative from the Integrated Bar, a representative from the private sector, and then a representative from the academe, professor of law. This case of Chavez versus JBC, it's included in this slide. I'm sharing simply because there was an issue actually on what a member.
our definition of the practice of law. We have three very good definitions of the practice of law. The practice of law is a profession. It is not a business or trade. Lawyering is not primarily meant to be a money-making venture. And law advocacy is not a capital that necessarily yields profits. Duty to the public service and to the administration of justice should be the primary consideration of lawyers. And gaining a livelihood is a secondary consideration. Very good definition, easier said than done. So our primary consideration is to administer justice. Gaining a livelihood is a secondary consideration only for us lawyers. Another definition of the practice of law.
Or when party rests case and real evidence consists of objects offered in court. Example, you may use a physical object to demonstrate its existence or identity, like for example, the serial number, documentary evidence, depending on the person.
In the Constitution that the JBC, the Judicial and Bar Council, shall be composed of 7 members. The Chief Justice as ex officio chairperson, the Secretary of Justice, very specific, as a member, ex officio member, and then a member from Congress, and then 4 other regular members, a representative from the retired Supreme Court Justices, very specific, a representative from the Integrated Bar, a representative from the private sector, and then a representative from the academe, professor of law. This case of Chavez versus JBC, it's included in this slide. I'm sharing simply because there was an issue actually on what a member.
Party rests case and real evidence consists of objects offered in court. Example, you may use a physical object to demonstrate its existence or identity. Like for example, the serial number on a computer found in a private residence could identify it as a government-owned property. Or for example, the gun that was used in case of murder. Now, the other type will be testimonial evidence. And what is testimonial evidence? You call a person to take the witness stand and his testimony is offered to prove, is being offered to prove specific purposes. The third type will be your documentary evidence. It is formally offered by the proponent immediately before he rests his case. A document may be an object of evidence or a documentary evidence depending on the person.
Action by which a party sues another for enforcement or protection of a right or prevention or redress of a wrong. So what are the keywords here? Enforcement, protection of right, prevention or redress of wrong. Tandaan nyo, enforce, protect, right, prevent, redress, wrong. Okay. Remedy by which a party seeks to establish 3 things. Status, right, particular fact. Okay. Ano yung sa television, yung commercial? SRP. Ano yung SRP? Suggested retail price. So tandaan nyo, established as
before the amendment, and for every allegation, it should be supported by evidence, because evidence is the means sanctioned by the rules in a judicial proceeding to establish what that equals to the truth. So if there is an allegation supported by evidence, then you're able to establish to the truth. But now it has been adjusted. Kindly take note of that. Why? Because today, for purposes of filing a pleading, for purposes of initiating a complaint, and this would include all other pleadings, even responsive pleadings, what is now the requirement of Google under Rule 6? That together with a pleading, initiatory pleading, which is made as an integral part thereof, would be what? Judicial agreements.
Is our definition of the practice of law. We have three very good definitions of the practice of law. The practice of law is a profession. It is not a business or trade. Lawyering is not primarily meant to be a money-making venture. And law advocacy is not a capital that necessarily yields profits. Duty to the public service and to the administration of justice should be the primary consideration of lawyers. And gaining a livelihood is a secondary consideration. Very good definition, easier said than done. So our primary consideration is to administer justice. Gaining a livelihood is a secondary consideration only for us lawyers. Another definition of the practice of law.
In Spouses Binjola versus Court of Appeals, the Supreme Court devised or laid down tests in determining whether a counterclaim is compulsory or permissive. There are four questions to be asked, my friends. The first question is, you check, okay? Sabi ko, compulsory or claim arises out or it is necessarily connected with transaction occurrence which is the subject matter of the complaint. Pag sinabi mong compulsory counterclaim, kaibigan, it is an offshoot of the complaint. There is a logical connection between the counterclaim and the subject matter of the complaint. Kaya sa bar exam, tinan nyo ang apat na test na ito. Number one, are the issues of fact or law raised?
What is a dispute? The dispute is a disagreement on a point of law or fact, a conflict of legal views or interests between two persons, natural or juridical. In the Republic Act 9285 or the ADR Act of 2004, it is defined as a process or procedure used to resolve a dispute or controversy other than by adjudication of a presiding judge of a court or an officer of a government agency in which a neutral third party participates to assist in the resolution of issues, which includes arbitration, mediation, conciliation, early neutral evaluation, mini trial, or any combination thereof. So we take note of the meaning. It is a process or a procedure.
Now, lifetime of a TRO issued by the RTC, by the Court of Appeals and by the Supreme Court. So, if it is issued by the RTC, you have 20 days. Within the 20-day period, then there shall be a hearing. The hearing is mandatory as regards to the application for preliminary injunction, either mandatory or prohibitory. Now, after the lapse of the 20-day period and there is no injunction issued, it becomes factus officio. Now, as far as Court of Appeals is concerned, the lifetime is 60 days. Now,
good day to our dear attendees from different parts of the country. I pray that you're all in great state of health. This free webinar is streaming live via the Villasis Law Center's YouTube channel and Facebook page. If you can hear my voice clearly, please type in the comment section hashtag VLC. Thank you. Yes, thank you. Optimize this learning opportunity. Share this free online lecture to your friends and together learn at the comfort of your homes. I want to formally welcome you all to this free webinar. This is part of a series of free online lectures brought to you by the Virtual Law Companion of Villasis Law Center. Allow me to share to you this good news. The Virtual Law Companion is the newest innovation of Villasis Law Center, which aims to provide an easy, convenient, and quality bar review experience. The Virtual Law Companion is a web application that is hosted on a dedicated cloud server. It can be accessed via the internet 24/7 for any web browser, using any device or handheld computers like Android or iOS phones. Meaning, you can study anytime, anywhere, and from any mobile device. Please visit our website at www.villasislawcenter.com to know more about our programs and activities. Before we formally start, please take note of some reminders. First, this free webinar is pre-recorded to ensure the uninterrupted streaming of lectures. Secondly, VLC team will be with you to assist you should you need more information about our program. Please visit and subscribe to our YouTube channel and Facebook page. Without further ado, please give your virtual class and welcome our lecturer today. Again, this free webinar is brought to you by our Virtual Law Companion. Maraming salamat po. Together, we can make things happen. Together, we can.
Our lecturer is a practicing lawyer with 15 years of experience in litigation, appellate court practice, government and private corporations, and the academe. He served as an associate litigation lawyer from June 2004 to August 2006 at the Gankay Kobalaspas and Associates Law Offices in Manila. He served as Court Attorney 5 from August 2006 to March 2015 at the Court of Appeals. From March 2015 to January 2016, he served as an Attorney 4 at the Adjudication Department, Legal Services Group of the Government Service Insurance System. From January 2016 to May 2016, he served as the Legal Department Manager of Astana Development Corporation, with offices in Eastwood City, Quezon City, a property and asset management company. From May 2016 to June 2017, He became a junior partner at the Gangkeiko Balaspas and Associates law offices in Manila. In July 2017, he started his own legal practice in the following areas of law, namely, contracts, property law and criminal law. In addition, he is a law professor at the Far Eastern University Institute of Law, Adamson University College of Law, University of the East College of Law and Lyceum of the Philippines, Cavite College of Law. He is a bar exam reviewer in civil law, and a lecturer in mandatory continuing legal education for lawyers. He received his Bachelor of Laws degree, cum laude, from the Silliman University, Dumaguete City, and Bachelor of Arts degree, major in political science, magna cum laude, from the Western Mindanao State University, Zamboanga City. He took and passed the 2003 Philippine bar examinations with a rating of 83.179%. He has attended several relevant trainings and seminar workshops and has written articles for the Far Eastern Law Review on the topics of gender equality, impeachment, children's rights, senior citizens and property law. Ladies and gentlemen, let us all welcome Professor Ali Akbar A. Jumrani.
Good day, everyone. I am Professor Ali Akbar Jumrani, and welcome to this free online lecture brought to you by the Virtual Law Companion of the Villasis Law Center. Prepare for the bar examinations anytime, anywhere, and from any mobile device. Check out the VLC website at www.villasislawcenter for more details and particulars. Optimize this learning opportunity, like the VLC Facebook page and share this FB Live session. Host a watch party via FB and tag your friends now, and together learn at the comfort of your homes. So before we start, please comment VLC if you can hear me clearly. Okay, very good. Thank you very much. So let's begin. So in today's so today we will talk about dealing with conflict of laws problems. As I am clearly aware, conflict of laws problem is one of the most difficult and maybe most misunderstood topics in civil law. As a matter of fact, more and more questions are asked about conflict of laws in the bar exams, but unfortunately, very few students or examinees get the answers right. So thankfully, Attorney Kit Villasis requested us to prepare this short lecture for the benefit of law students as well as bar examinees. Indeed, there is nothing in the law that is difficult for as long as we are able to study it and understand in a way that it should be, then any questions can be answered, particularly on the topic of conflict of laws, daunting though it may sound. All right, so first we begin with definition. So what is conflict of laws? Conflict of laws is that part of municipal law which governs cases involving a foreign element. It is that part of the law of each state or nation which determines whether, in dealing with a legal situation, the law of some other state or nation will be recognized, given effect, or applied. It is that part of municipal law of a state which directs its courts and administrative agencies, when confronted with a legal problem involving a foreign element, whether or not they should apply a foreign law. So notice from these three definitions that the common term is a foreign element. So what is a foreign element? That's the question. A foreign element can be a person, property, place, or transaction which is not Filipino or Philippine-based. You know, as the world gets smaller because of globalization and tourism, more and more Filipinos interact with foreign nationals, get jobs abroad, execute overseas contracts, and buy properties situated abroad. So to better understand this, let us look at some problems with foreign elements. So first, a Filipina married to an American man in rights celebrated in Tagaytay City. In this problem or situation, the foreign element is the American spouse or the foreigner spouse. Now, the rest of the terms or incidents in the problem are all based in the Philippines. Now, of course, if the husband was a Filipino, then it would be a marriage between two Filipinos celebrated in the Philippines. Therefore, we apply Philippine law because that is not a conflict of laws problem due to the absence of a foreign element. But this one has a foreign element. Therefore, this is a conflict of laws situation. Next, an Australian tourist arrested in NAIA for possession of dangerous drugs. So what is the foreign element in this statement? The foreign element is the Australian tourist. The culprit or the suspect in the crime is a foreigner. Now there is a conflict of laws issue here because you have Philippine law trying to be applied to a foreigner who is subject to a different national law. Now, the third situation is a wealthy Cebuano who owns real properties in Hawaii, USA. The foreign element here is the location of the real properties. Now, this presents a conflict of laws problem because different rules apply to properties situated in different places. Okay. Now, fourth example is an Englishman who fathered a child with a Filipina, both of whom are living in Makati City. The foreign element here is, of course, the Englishman or the foreigner father. Now, here, this is a conflict of laws problem because the foreigner here is subject to a different rule or different law and not necessarily Philippine law. So how do we settle or resolve the problem when we speak of support or custody, etc.? So this is an example of a conflict of laws problem. Now, lastly, a Filipino hired by an American IT company and working at the latter's headquarters in Singapore. So in this situation, we have two foreign elements. First is the employer, which is an American IT company. And second is the place of employment, which is Singapore. So you have now two different foreign elements governed or subject to different laws. One is American law and the other one is Singaporean law. And of course, the Filipino who is under Philippine law. So these situations are quite common. These are not invented situations, although of course they are fictional, but these situations are quite common, acknowledging the fact that more and more Filipinos interact with foreigners, enter into employment or other contracts abroad, and even buy properties abroad. So these are the examples of problems with foreign elements. And I hope that very basic issue or topic of foreign element is clear to you by now. So when problems arise in these situations, the question is always, what law will apply? Is it the law of the foreigner or Philippine law? That is when conflicts of laws will come in. So far, I hope I'm clear. And I'd like to see if you are following me. Please comment VLC in the comment section. Okay, thank you. All right. Now, we have defined conflict of laws. Now, what is the purpose or object of conflict of laws? The object or function of conflict of laws is to provide rational and valid rules or guidelines in deciding cases where either the parties, events, or transactions are linked to more than one jurisdiction. So instead of different rules, different laws trying to compete, you know, or different parties trying to guess what law should apply, conflict of laws as a branch of Philippine municipal law tries to settle or tries to uniformalize or be consistent in what laws or rules to apply in situations where there are foreign elements. So, conflict of laws provisions in the Civil Code. So, guess what? Ever since the 1950s, when the Civil Code was enacted, we have had conflict of laws rules in our Civil Code. So these are the following. So we'll start with Article 15 of the Civil Code. Article 15 states, laws relating to family rights and duties or to the status, condition, and legal capacity of persons are binding upon citizens of the Philippines, even though living abroad. I'll give you an example. A Filipino who is less than 18 years of age cannot enter into a contract under Philippine law, his national law. Because here, our age of majority is 18 and above. If he travels to a country where the legal age is lower than 18 years old, he still cannot enter into a contract in that country because his national law follows him wherever he may be. Of course, if he decides to be naturalized in that country and become a citizen of that country, then Philippine laws will not apply to him because by then he would have a different national law. Okay, so Article 15 is the national law principle. Next, conflict of laws rule or provision in the civil code is Article 16. It states, real property as well as personal property is subject to the law of the country where it is situated. I'll give you an example. A Filipino bought a property in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. The law there in Malaysia shall apply and govern the use, enjoyment, and disposition of that property. So even if, for example, we can donate real property to a religious organization here, but if it is not allowed in Kuala Lumpur, then that property cannot be donated to a religious organization. Okay, because the law of the place where the property is located shall apply with respect to the disposition of that property, even though between the parties here in the Philippines, that donation would be allowed. See how the laws of the place of the property can suppress the law between the parties like Filipinos in the Philippines. Okay, now, the second paragraph of Article 16 is more controversial, and this is about succession. So the second paragraph states, intestate and testamentary successions, both with respect to the order of succession and to the amount of successional rights, and to the intrinsic validity of testamentary provisions, shall be regulated by the national law of the person whose succession is under consideration, whatever may be the nature of the property and regardless of the country wherein said property may be found. Now, I'll give you an example. Remember the property in Malaysia. Okay? If the Philippine owner of that property dies, okay, whether here or abroad, his succession and the disposal of that property shall be in accordance with Philippine law, his national law. Hence, even if there is no concept of legitim in Malaysia, that property shall still be reserved as legitim of the compulsory heirs of the Philippine owner pursuant to Philippine law. So the law on legitim will now affect the disposition of that property. Okay, regardless, of course, of the law of Malaysia with respect to the disposition of that property. Okay, now, of course, if in Malaysia there are some requirements such as taxes or other government regulations, like clearances and all that, before a property located there can be transferred or conveyed to an heir, then, of course, those rules should be followed. But those are just subsequent to the main issue, which is, who shall inherit those properties? Which question shall be resolved applying Philippine law on succession? Okay, the next conflict of laws provision is Article 17 of the Civil Code. Now, according to this provision, the forms and solemnities of contracts, wills, and other public instruments shall be governed by the laws of the country in which they are executed. Example, under Philippine law, a notarial will should be witnessed by at least 3 witnesses who should sign on every page of the will. But assuming that a Filipino, while working in Greece, executed a will, but it was not witnessed by at least 3 witnesses, if it is valid there in Greece, where it was executed, it shall be valid here in the Philippines. And it can be probated here in the Philippines. Why? Because as far as formalities are concerned or the due execution of a contract is concerned, like how many witnesses, whether it should be notarized, it is the law of the place where that contract or will was executed that will apply. And if the law of the place does not require formalities, then it is valid there. In the Philippines, it shall also be deemed valid because that is only considered extrinsic or external. But if, let's say, it's a will and it was executed abroad, not in compliance with the formalities under Philippine law, even if it can be probated here in the Philippines because of Article 17, as far as the dispositions of the will, meaning to say as to who shall receive what or how much should an heir receive, we will still apply Philippine law and not the Greek law, like in this situation. Why? Because by then, the question is already order of succession. Like what we said earlier, it shall be the national law of the deceased which should prevail, and no longer the law of the place where the property is located or where the will was executed. So see, we have these provisions in the civil code which hope to govern and settle controversies arising from the situations already stated. Okay. Now, about location or place of execution, Article 17 also provides that when the contracts, wills, and other public instruments are executed before the diplomatic or consular officials of the Republic of the Philippines in a foreign country, the solemnities established by Philippine laws shall be observed in their execution. So imagine if that will, which was executed in Greece, okay, was executed before the embassy of the Philippines in Athens, Greece. So in that case, that will is deemed to have been executed in Philippine soil. So we apply Philippine law. So we apply the requirement that a notarial will should be witnessed by at least 3 witnesses. Okay, this is pursuant to the extraterritoriality principle of Philippine laws. Meaning to say, we consider our embassies and other Philippine properties abroad as extension of our properties, as extension of Philippine property or territory. Okay, now this is very important. This is the third paragraph of Article 17, which states that prohibitive laws concerning persons, their acts or property, and those which have for their object public order, public policy, and good customs shall not be rendered ineffective by laws or judgments promulgated or by determinations or conventions agreed upon in a foreign country. Example, Filipinos cannot avoid the prohibition against divorce by traveling to a country where divorce is allowed and get divorced there. Okay, because as Filipinos, you are subject to the prohibition against divorce. Similar to, let's say, bigamy. Okay, bigamous marriages are void here in the Philippines. So that prohibition applies to Filipinos here in the Philippines as well as abroad, okay, while they are Filipinos. So they cannot travel abroad and go to a country where bigamy is allowed and then marry there, and then expect that when they come back here in the Philippines, that bigamous marriage will be recognized here in the Philippines. No, because again, bigamous marriages are void under Philippine law. This is an example of a prohibitive law, and it applies to a Filipino wherever that Filipino is. Okay. All right. So those are the 3 provisions in the civil code that are our fundamental or basic conflict of laws rules with respect to the situations or transactions contemplated by these provisions. So if you will recall, so first, with respect to the personal status and legal capacity of persons, Philippine law will apply. That's because of the nationality principle. As far as properties are concerned, it is the law of the place where it is located. So the disposition of that property will be according to the laws of that foreign country if that property is located abroad. But here in the Philippines, if it is found here and if the owner is a foreigner, the foreigner will have to follow Philippine law with respect to the disposition of the property. And of course, as far as succession is concerned, you apply Philippine national law or the national law of a foreigner who died here in the Philippines and whose succession is now being considered. And of course, lastly, with respect to the formalities of contracts, it's lex loci celebrationis, or the law of the place where it is executed, unless, of course, it is executed in a Philippine embassy. So basically, those are the things. Easy to memorize. You can just memorize them. But the problem is, how do we apply them? Okay, there is more to this lecture. So I hope you are still glued to this. And let's maximize this learning session. No, I invite you to tag a friend to this FB Live or host a watch party, because you wouldn't want to miss the next few slides. All right. So what are the sources of conflict of laws? So we have civil codes of different countries. Okay, our civil code being the priority. Okay. Also, we have the constitution. We have provisions in the constitutions regulating foreign ownership. That's an example of a conflict of laws provision. We also have special statutes like investments by foreigners, even rights and obligations between foreigners and Filipinos in a marital situation. Okay, we have treaties and international conventions like the conventions, different conventions on air transportation and cargo handling, and even sale of goods, you know, between countries. And of course, works of distinguished jurists and studies of learned societies. Now, these are the same sources as public international law. But of course, by now you know that public international law is different from conflict of laws because public international law governs sovereign states, the relations between sovereign states. But conflict of laws governs the relations between private individuals. As a matter of fact, conflict of laws is also called private international law. It's a private law because it governs private individuals, but partly it is international law because it involves individuals from different nations or different countries. All right, so let's continue. So here, let us look at common conflict of laws terms. Okay. Now, of course, to add some weight or to add some sophistication to your answer in the bar or even in your discussions in classes, or why not even in your conversations, you can use some of these principles, but of course try to use them accurately, you know, instead of just saying them out of instinct like Duralex and Lex. Okay, so let's start with Lex domicili. So Lex domicili means law of the domicile or the law of one's domicile applied in the choice of law. Domicile meaning it's like residence, but it's the habitual residence, that place where you have the intention to return to, okay, regardless of being away from that place. All right, next is Lex Fori, law of the forum, the positive law of the state, country, or jurisdiction where the suit is brought. Also, Lex Loci Contractus, or the law of the place where the contract was made, or law of the place where the contract is to govern. Now also, Lex Loci Rei Citae, the law of the place where the thing or subject matter is located. Okay, so this is Article 16, first paragraph of the Civil Code. Now, Lex Loci Actus is the law of the place where the act was done. Lex Loci Celebrationis, law of the place where the contract is made. Lex Loci Solutionis, law of the place where payment or performance is to be made. Okay. And lastly, and next is Lex Loci Delicti Commissi, law of the place where the delict or tort was committed. Now, these principles are not independent and they are not stand alone. These principles must be adopted in a municipal law or in a local law. So like in the Philippines, we have adopted Lex Loci Celebrationis, Lex Loci Solutionis, and Lex Loci Delicti Commissi. Now, when you travel abroad, we don't know if in that case, it's a different situation, you know, if they apply a different rule. But as far as Philippine law, because is concerned, because remember, conflict of laws is still a municipal issue or a municipal legal system, you know, we still apply Philippine law. So these are the principles that have been adopted by Philippine law. And so I am giving these not just as mere examples of a concept, but that these are also the principles that we have subscribed to, okay, that the Philippines has subscribed to. Okay, the national theory is the status and capacity of an individual, and these are generally governed by the law of his nationality. And what did I say earlier? This is Article 16, second paragraph of the Civil Code respecting order of succession. Okay. Also, Article 15 on the legal capacity, status, and other personal circumstances of a Filipino. Now, forum nonconvenience means that the forum is inconvenient. The controversy may be more suitably tried elsewhere. And lastly, the renvoi doctrine, where a jural matter is presented, which the conflict of laws rules of the forum refer to a foreign law, which in turn refers the matter back to the law of the forum or third state. Nosebleed? Well, don't worry, because we will have examples of forum nonconvenience and renvoi doctrine. So just hang in there. Okay. So we'll now go to issues in conflict of laws. So this topic is about dealing with conflict of laws problems. So when you say deal, that means there is a problem. Okay? So how do we deal with this conflict of laws problems? Well, first, before you deal with something, you have to know if there is an issue. In all legal problems or in all legal controversies, we must identify the issue or the contention, okay, between the parties, where the controversy is. So in a conflict of laws problem, the controversy usually revolves around the following. So first is jurisdiction of the court. Second, the choice of law, meaning to say what law to apply. And lastly, recognition and enforcement of foreign judgments. Now, let me know, what do you think? Do you think these are real issues, especially when there is a foreign element involved, or when another jurisdiction or another law will be applied or will be considered? Or should we just insist on Philippine law as an exercise of our sovereignty? What do you think? Should it be Philippine sovereignty, or should we also consider a foreign law? Well, of course, that's why we call it conflict of laws, because not in all situations can the Philippines assert or exercise its sovereignty. You know, Philippine sovereignty cannot be extended to foreign nationals. It can only be extended in so far as rules and regulations involving public order, public policy, etc. But with respect to the person and the property of a foreigner, well, that is outside of Philippine sovereignty. These are protected by, of course, international human rights conventions, that a person, regardless of his nationality, has a right to life, liberty, and property. So that's why there are situations when we need to consider a foreign law. Okay, so those are the issues in a conflict of laws situation or problem. So these are the steps, okay, to deal with a conflict problem. And the steps are followed, or the steps follow a question type form. So it's like preparing a checklist. And if the court, remember, it's the court who conducts this process, no? Of course, with the help of lawyers, but ultimately, it's the court which will decide the problem or the case. So going through this motion, going through these steps, the court will ultimately hope that it will be able to decide the case through a lawful jurisdiction and after applying the correct law. So it's a, you know, it's a mental as well as it is a psychological process, I think, because the court here must, you know, consider all circumstances, not just the question of the law. It's not just asking, is this right or wrong, you know, or will the plaintiff, or is the plaintiff correct? Does the plaintiff have a cause of action? It's not just those issues, but rather the court has to determine jurisdictional issue as well as choice of law. Okay, so first is that the court will determine, initially determine whether to dismiss it or to assume jurisdiction. Now, jurisdiction is, of course, conferred by law and by the Constitution. It cannot be the subject of stipulation or consent by the parties. Now, in the Philippines, our law and jurisdiction is, of course, Batas Pambansa Bilang 29, or the Judiciary Reorganization Act. Now, that law has been amended subsequently by a lot of laws, and also by significant and pertinent memoranda and issuances of the Supreme Court. But the jurisdiction, at least the general concept of jurisdiction, has remained the same since the passage of Batas Pambansa Bilang 129. And so whether the court has jurisdiction over a conflict of laws problem will be determined by the following. So first, does it have judicial jurisdiction? Does it have the power or authority to try the case, render judgment thereon, and execute it in accordance with law? That jurisdiction is, of course, determined by law. Now, also similarly, legal jurisdiction. Does the state have the jurisdiction to promulgate law and enforce them on all persons and property within its jurisdiction, okay, or within its territory? So, like what I said, certain foreigners are exempt or immune from the legal and judicial jurisdiction of the state. For example, diplomats, okay, ambassadors, okay, because they are, of course, protected by the diplomatic immunity as representatives of a sovereign state. You know, they cannot be the subject of Philippine laws, because it is like saying that the Philippines is trying to assert its jurisdiction over another state, and that is not allowed under Philippine law. Okay, so those are the questions that must be determined first by the court. Now, the jurisdiction over the subject matter is the jurisdiction over the controversy, over the issue. Now, the issue or the subject matter is usually determined from the allegations in the complaint or in the petition. Also, the prayer of the complaint or the petition can help in knowing or ascertaining the subject matter of the case. Okay. Now, next is jurisdiction over the person of the parties. The court has to have jurisdiction over the person of the plaintiff or the defendant. Now, it's not difficult to say that the court has jurisdiction over the plaintiff, because the plaintiff files the petition. So it's a voluntary submission or acknowledgement of the jurisdiction of the court. So you cannot go to court, ask for affirmative reliefs, and then deny the jurisdiction of the court. Of course, by filing the petition or the complaint, you are recognizing the court. Now, the problem usually is over the defendant. So the court acquires jurisdiction over the defendant by serving serving summons over the defendant. Now, because this is a conflict of laws problem, what if the defendant is a foreigner residing abroad? Now, that will present a problem to the plaintiff as well as to the court, because the case cannot proceed until the court acquires jurisdiction. And it's not easy to assume or acquire jurisdiction over a defendant who is living abroad or who is residing abroad. I know the rules of court has provisions on how to serve summons over a foreigner defendant. But then again, you know, those provisions are more the exception rather than the general rule. The general rule would be that it is difficult for a court to acquire jurisdiction over a foreigner who is residing abroad. Okay, and lastly, jurisdiction over the property. It results either from the compulsory processes such as attachment and seizure of the property. Of course, assuming that the property is here in the Philippines. If the property is located abroad, our courts cannot send a writ of attachment or a writ of replevin over those properties. You know, so that would be a problem for the court if a property is located elsewhere and the controversy is about recovery of that property or possession of that property. So those are the considerations of a court. I know we are not judges yet, but at least you have an idea. Okay, ano, kaya pa ba? Kaya pa? Andiyan pa kayo? Alright, sige. Let's continue. Now, like what I said, this is a process. So let's say the court has assumed jurisdiction over the case. Now, the question is the court the convenient court? Because even if the court has jurisdiction over the case, let's say it's a case for specific performance of a contract. Okay, a Filipino wants to enforce a contract against a foreigner employer. Okay, Now, that action, specific performance, is within the jurisdiction of the court under Batas Pamansal Bilang 129. It is for enforcement and implementation. It is an action based on a written contract. So that is within the judicial jurisdiction of a regional trial court. But the question is it a convenient court? Now, what is inconvenient or convenient? Okay, so this is what we call the doctrine of forum non-convenience. So what are the situations that make a forum not a convenient court? And when you say inconvenient, to whom is the court supposedly inconvenient? Is it to the plaintiff or the defendant? Okay, so the doctrine of forum non-convenience states that even if the court assumes jurisdiction over the parties and the subject matter, it may decline to try the case on the ground that the controversy may be more suitably tried elsewhere. Now, what are the reasons for refusing to try the case? So first, there is another available and more appropriate forum in which the ends of justice would be better served in view of the interests of all the parties. Also, to avoid global forum shopping, which is the filing of repetitious suits in courts of different jurisdictions. So, in the example that I gave, what if the Filipino filed a case for specific performance before the regional trial court in the Philippines against a foreigner employer, let's say, working and residing in Hong Kong. Now, the Philippine court, even though it has jurisdiction over the case, over the subject matter of the case, may be an inconvenient court. Why? Because it does not have the process by which to serve summons. And also, even if it can serve summons and acquire jurisdiction over the defendant foreigner employer, the court would not be in a position to enforce the judgment, okay, if that judgment is favorable to the Filipino plaintiff. So the court can dismiss or refuse to entertain the case and just recommend that the case be tried in Hong Kong, because the Hong Kong court would be a more convenient court. Okay, but take note that the Supreme Court has consistently held that the doctrine of forum non-convenience is not absolute, and it's not a very strict and solid principle. Instead, it should be considered on a case-to-case basis. So in the case of Saudi Arabian Airlines versus Court of Appeals decided in October 1998, the Supreme Court said that unless the balance is strongly in favor of the defendant, the plaintiff's choice of forum should rarely be disturbed. As much as possible, the court should afford the plaintiff the remedies that the plaintiff is seeking and hopefully is entitled under Philippine law. So by hearing the case in Philippines, no unnecessary difficulties and inconvenience have been shown by either of the parties. Thus, in the absence of any proof of inconveniences or difficulties, the choice of forum of the plaintiff should be upheld. Okay, so next is the question on choice of law. And here we are more experiencing problems, so to speak, you know. But again, like what I said earlier, it's not really a problem if we are, you know, familiar with the process, familiar with the rules. You know, ultimately, we can have a very easy, easy problem for all of us. You know, it's like, you know, going from point A to point B. Okay, so in knowing or in deciding what law to apply, the court will follow the following steps. Okay, so first, general rule is that apply the law of the forum. Well, it's very basic that, you know, this is a Philippine court. We are Filipinos, okay? So we are subject to Philippine laws. So our preference is to apply Philippine law because that's the law that we know, that's the law that we live with. Okay, so general rule is apply the law of the forum. But what if the law of the forum is not the correct law? Okay? So it would be unfair to the parties, and it would be illegal to apply Philippine law to a situation involving a foreign element which should have been regulated by a foreign law. Okay, so to avoid that mistake, the court has to do the following. So first is what we call the subject matter characterization. So this is done by classifying a factual situation into a legal category. It is of appreciable significance because the legal category to which an issue is assigned determines the governing law. Okay? So the court doesn't stop at looking at the allegations of the complaint or at looking who the parties are or the nationalities of the parties, but the court has to characterize the subject matter and place it or classify it as a specific legal category and know if that legal category is within Philippine law or it should be governed by a foreign law. Next is the substance procedure characterization. Now, this is also another tool to help the court because under this step, the substance and procedure characterization, if the issue is substantive, the court may apply a foreign law. Of course, depending on the subject matter because it could also be Philippine law. But at least that gives the opportunity of applying a foreign law. But then, if it is procedural, it is supposed to follow the law of the forum, meaning to say Philippine law. So what are procedural questions? Well, usually procedural questions are those questions that involve the enforcement of a right. Substantive question is a question that is the law or that provision that answers the question, does the plaintiff have the right? Does the defendant have the obligation? So it's usually the what, okay? But when you say procedural law, it's usually the how, okay, of the problem. All right, so if it's procedural, you apply Philippine law, okay? So that's the second instrument, or that's the second step. Now, the third step is the significant relationship test. So the law of the country with the significant relationship to the transaction and the parties should be followed. So in the case of contracts, well, this is a case. In the case of Philippine Export versus Eusebio, the Supreme Court said that if the contract was executed abroad in a specific country and the parties also perform their obligations in that country, one of the parties is also a resident or citizen of that country, and the only thing different is that the plaintiff is a Filipino. Obviously here, between the Philippines and that foreign country has the most significant relationship with the people, the transactions, and maybe the property involved in the problem. Okay, so in that case, you apply, of course, the foreign law. But if the situation is in reverse, okay, you have a foreigner party to a contract, but this contract is was executed in the Philippines. It was also performed in the Philippines, and the property is in the Philippines. The other party is a Filipino. Clearly, the Philippines has the most significant relationship with the transactions involved in the controversy. Thus, we apply Philippine law. Now, next step is to know if the foreign law, as alleged in the case, has been duly proven. Because if it was not duly proven, then we do not take judicial notice of that foreign law. Meaning to say the court will not entertain a foreign law simply because one of the parties says that the foreign law will apply. It has to be proved. Okay? Even though a lawyer or a judge has the same access to the law, okay, through the internet or otherwise, but that law must be submitted or must be admitted as evidence of the case. Okay, so if it's not proven, then we apply the doctrine of processual presumption. And this presumption or this doctrine states that where the foreign law is not pleaded, or even if pleaded, is not proved, the presumption is that foreign law is the same as ours. Hence, we apply foreign law and not the foreign law. Okay, so far, are you still with me? I hope I was able to somehow simplify the concepts and the steps. And if you think that I have, in fact, made it simple to you, please comment yes in the comment section right now. All right, thank you. All right, now let's do some exercises. Okay. The best way to understand the legal problems is to try to apply them and put them in, you know, sample problems, you know, in actual problems. Okay, so first is annulment of a contract which was executed in Seoul, Korea on the ground that the Filipino party was incapacitated to enter into a contract. So that is the situation. What is the subject matter of the case? Annulment of contract, execution of the contract. But then look at the problem. The reason for the annulment of the contract is the alleged lack of capacity of the Filipino party to the contract. So clearly, okay, the subject matter of the case is capacity or legal capacity. Okay. Now, do Philippine courts have jurisdiction? Yes. Why? Because annulment of contracts is within the jurisdiction of the Regional Trial Court of the Philippines. Okay. Now, what law should apply? Since we are talking about the capacity of the Filipino, we apply Article 15 of the Civil Code, which states that as far as legal capacity of a Filipino is concerned, Philippine law shall apply. So Philippine law will apply, okay? Because the subject matter here is legal capacity. So see how we did it. We started with subject matter characterization, and then after finding that the subject matter is one that is within the jurisdiction of the court, then we check what law will apply to that subject matter. So in this case, legal capacity of a Filipino. Okay, the national law of the Filipino will apply pursuant to Article 15 as well as Article 17, last paragraph of the Civil Code. Okay, next. Enforcement of a purchase by a Brazilian national of a parcel of land in the Philippines, the contract of which was executed in Sao Paulo, Brazil. Okay, first let us look at the foreign elements. No, the very basic or first step in looking and reading a conflict of laws problem. So first you have a Brazilian buyer. Okay, so that's the foreign element. Next, the second foreign element is that the contract or the place of execution of the contract was in Brazil. So you have two foreign elements. So clearly this is a conflict of laws problem. But what is the subject matter of the case? Okay. Is it the property which is situated in the Philippines? That is location, that is not a legal issue. Okay. Is it the purchase of the Brazilian national? Well, could be. Or is it the due execution of the contract? Okay. What are the rules applicable to the contract as far as the Brazilian law is concerned? Is that the subject matter of the controversy? Well, the subject matter of the controversy here is the validity of the purchase. Because before a contract can be enforced, that contract should be valid and legal from the very beginning. So that is the subject matter, validity of the purchase, as a preliminary issue before we can enforce the contract as prayed for by the Brazilian national. So does the Philippine court have jurisdiction? Okay. Yes. Why? Because we are talking about a purchase of a property, okay, located in the Philippines. And enforcement or nullity or validity of a contract is also within the jurisdiction of the Regional Trial Court. Now, what law should apply? Okay. Should we apply the law of the place where the contract was executed? Or should we apply the national law of the Brazilian buyer? Well, the answer is we apply the law of the place where the property is located. And here it's the here it is Philippine law because the property is located in the Philippines. Now, what law is that? Of course, it's the Constitution of the Philippines. And under the Constitution of the Philippines, a foreign national cannot acquire lands in the Philippines. Okay. All right. Last sample problem. A claim filed by the owner of a Vietnamese vessel which sank near Palawan and was a total wreck as certified by the Philippine Navy. the Vietnamese insurer of the vessel denied the ship owner's claim on the ground that the fact and proof of the loss is not acceptable because the Philippine Navy is not the proper authority contemplated by law or even by the insurance policy. So it's quite a complicated problem. And you see, life is always complicated, more so with conflict of loss problem. Now, so what is the subject matter of the case? The subject matter of the case here is not the sinking, okay? No, it is not the nationality of the vessel, no. It is not the notice or proof of loss, no. Okay? It is not the authority of Philippine Navy to declare a shipwreck, okay, no. All these will only be questions of evidence because ultimately the subject matter or the main issue here is the liability of the insurer. Okay. Now, question, does the court have jurisdiction? Yes, it has jurisdiction over the case, but wait, okay? We will have to answer the third question. So what law shall apply? So here, the country with the most significant relationship here is, okay, Vietnam. Why? Because the vessel is a Vietnamese vessel. Okay. And of course, I will suppose that in this problem, the owner is also a Vietnamese national. Okay. Third, the insurer is Vietnamese. And fourth, we will assume that the contract is governed by Vietnamese insurance law. Okay. So in all these cases, we apply Vietnamese law, not Philippine law. Okay. Even if the claim is filed here, okay, or the action against the Vietnamese insurer is filed here. Now, because Vietnamese law will apply, also because the parties are Vietnamese, okay, the evidence would be in Vietnam. The court is not a convenient court. The Philippine court is not a convenient court. Hence, going back to the second question, even if the Philippine court has jurisdiction, but it can refuse to entertain the case because of the doctrine of forum non-convenience and send the parties to Vietnam. All right. Huh. Diba exciting? Exciting ang conflict of laws. If you can play around, of course, when I say play around, you don't play around, like literally play around and fool the court. No. But when you do this exercise of subject matter characterization, determining whether the court has jurisdiction, and ultimately knowing the right law to apply, then we can help the courts to preliminarily decide whether it should entertain the court, whether it should entertain the case or not. Okay, but ultimately, whether the case is within the jurisdiction of the court or if the case calls for the application of a foreign law, these are the instances when the foreign law should not be applied at any time. You know, these are common grounds or reasons why a foreign law should not be applied. So I want you to go over them, and then some of them may be very familiar to you already. Pursuant to the basic principles on extraterritoriality, as well as human rights, and of course, lastly, on the interest of public policy. All right. Now, notice and proof of law. So if the foreign law has been identified or has been determined to be applicable in the case, so the following must be observed. No? So first, we cannot take, or our courts do not take judicial notice of a foreign law. It should be duly proven as a fact and as evidence. So how is it proved? So first, get an official publication of the law. Okay, so if it is Australian law, for example, then go to Sydney, or of course, if you can get a copy online, get a copy, provided it is official publication. Okay, so how do you decide or how do you know if this is an official publication? Well, check if you can get it from the officer having legal custody of the record, because only the copy, the official copy with the official custodian can be entertained. So copies from other sources in the internet or in a library cannot be accepted as proof of that law. Now, lastly, for purposes of due execution, we require, the courts require that it must be duly authenticated by the Philippine consul by attaching his consular seal. So in the problem given, if it is an Australian law that you wish to prove in court here in the Philippines, get a copy, the official copy from the official custodian. Most probably it's Congress or Parliament, okay, the Parliament of Australia in Sydney, right? And then have that duly authenticated by the Philippine consulate in Sydney. So that's the proof of the foreign law. Okay, now lastly, I would like to talk about the renvoi. Okay, ano ba tong renvoi na to? Ayan. So also, do you think I have pronounced it right? Is it renvoi? Okay, so please comment down below if I have pronounced it correctly by typing yes, okay, or just VLC. Okay, let's see. Renvoi. Is it renvoi or renvoi? Well, whether it's renvoi or renvoi, okay, this is the meaning. Okay, but, well, seriously speaking, it's pronounced as renvoi. All right, renvoi is a procedure whereby a jural matter presented is referred by the conflict of laws rules of the forum to a foreign state. The conflict of law rule of which, in turn, refers the matter to the law of the forum or a third state. Sabi ko sa inyo from the very beginning, in the list of the doctrines, or the Latin maxims, this is different to understand because of so many terms and words. But this is better, or you can understand this better by illustrating it. So here we go. So first, a case is filed before a Philippine court. Okay. The Philippine court, okay, following the steps that I mentioned earlier, okay, will determine the subject matter and if that subject matter is governed by foreign law. Okay, so meaning to say, it will start by checking if the subject matter is within the jurisdiction of Philippine courts under BP Bilang 129, and then secondly, it will check if the subject matter is governed by a foreign law. Okay, again, following the subject matter. Subject matter characterization, the substance procedure dichotomy, as well as the significant relationship test. So kung foreign law nga ang applicable dito, then the parties will have to prove, okay, first the law, okay? So following the requirements on notice and proof of law, of foreign law. Now, the judge will evaluate the foreign law, okay? Read through the foreign law. Now, if the foreign law applies lex situs, or law of the place where the property is located, also if it applies, if that foreign law uses lex contractus, law of the place where the contract was executed, or also lex domicili, you need to say the law of the domicile of the national, okay, then it might, okay, refer back to the Philippines, okay? If the property is located in the Philippines, if the contract was executed in the Philippines, or if that foreigner is domiciled in the Philippines. So here now happens the renvoi, because the Philippine court defers, okay, to a foreign law. But that foreign law, inside that foreign law, it says that the matter should be resolved by the law of the place, okay, of the property, of the execution of the contract, or the domicile of the national. So, in effect, that law is deferring to the Philippines, okay, or its legal system. So that's why the Philippine court will now retain jurisdiction and proceed to try the case. So that is the concept of renvoi. It's like throwing back to you, throwing back or bouncing back to the Philippine court of the controversy because of the internal law of that foreign country refers back the matter to the place, okay, where the contract was executed, where the property is located, or where the foreigner is domiciled. Okay. Kaya pa? Andiyan pa kayo? All right. So, renvoi in action. And this is the classic case of Aznar versus Garcia. Okay. So, well, yeah, this is quite a long case, but these are the important points in that case. So, But before I begin, because we are now in the final part of my presentation, please, please, please comment yes, okay, in the comment section below if you are learning a lot from this session. I hope so. Okay, now, again, I would like to thank the Villasis Law Center for this opportunity. And please, please check the website, okay, for all other learning opportunities that you can get. Okay, so let's now go back to Aznar versus Garcia. So there is no question that here, Edward Christensen was a citizen of the United States and of the state of California at the time of his death. But then there is also no question that at the time of his death, he was domiciled in the Philippines. Now, Article 946 of the Civil Code of California has a domiciliary theory, right, or a domiciliary rule, which states that if there is no law to the contrary in the place where the personal property is situated, it is deemed to follow the person of its owner and is governed by the law of his domicile. So between the national law, which is California law, and the law of domicile, in this case, Philippine law, according or applying the Civil Code of California, it should be Philippine law that will apply with respect to the personal property of Edward Christensen. And as the domicile of the deceased Edward Christensen, a citizen of California, is the Philippines, the validity of the provisions of his will, depriving his acknowledged natural child, should be governed by Philippine law, okay, pursuant to Article 946 of the Civil Code of California, and not by the internal law of California. So here, as a sort of a background, the acknowledged child of Christensen filed an action to probate the will of Edward Christensen, who died in the Philippines, who lived for a few years in the Philippines before he died. So of course, the relatives of Mr. Christensen were saying, well, he is a foreign national. He is an American citizen. As a matter of fact, he is a citizen of the state of California. So his national law should apply, okay? Following also Article 16, second paragraph, we said that the national law will apply over the order of succession to the deceased person. But then going to the national law of the deceased, the state of California law, there is a conflict of laws provision there, which is that it should be the domiciliary law that should apply. So that's why the matter was returned, okay, of course, figuratively, returned to the Philippine law, okay, for proper disposition. So that's why the court retained jurisdiction over this case and applied the civil law on succession. So that's why the acknowledged child now received a share in the estate of Mr. Christensen following her legitimate, which is protected and preserved under Philippine law. Okay, so that's about it. In fact, that is the end of our lecture. So as a recap, so I hope you were able to listen and take note of the basic provisions on conflict of laws, the definition, the concepts, and the common issues or matters raised in a conflict of laws problem. Now, more importantly, because this topic is about dealing with a conflict of laws problems, you were able to listen and imagine, okay, the steps that I discussed to you about characterization of the subject matter, characterization of the law, whether it is substantive or procedural, and then applying, okay, the process of deciding what law to apply. Okay, ultimately, again, we say that this branch of the law applies to situations where there are foreign elements. Now, if you still believe or think that this is a very isolated or rare branch of law, well, your answer is wrong, okay? Because again, as more and more Filipinos travel abroad, well, of course, this is before the COVID and hopefully soon, okay, after this pandemic, more and more people travel abroad, more and more Filipinos intermarry with foreigners, more and more Filipinos acquire properties abroad, then there will be more relevance, okay, to the conflict of laws rules. Okay, so this is timely
And so I hope you will bring home valuable information from this lecture. So again, I am Attorney Ali Akbar Jumrani. By the way, I have a YouTube channel. It's called The House of Law. House spelled as H-O-W-S. Okay, you might want to check that out for short lectures on law and everything about life as a lawyer, as a law student, or as a law professor. So again, thank you very much, Villasis Law Center, for this opportunity to lecture on conflict of laws.